in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Who sees firsthand the concrete and mortar, the guard posts and machine gun towers, the dog runs and the barbed wire, can ever again take for granted his or her freedom or the precious gift that is America.
Stuff you've heard about America not wanting to fight, wanting to stay out of the war, a lot of horse dung. Americans love to fight. All real Americans love staying in battle.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Welcome to PoliticalVindication.com on the air. Brought to you by the CB Media Network. My name is Frank. I'm here with Shane. And like we do every Tuesday at 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on Blog Talk Radio, we're here to do our part to make the reign of Barack Hussein Obama a one-term phenomenon. Political Vindication Radio is a show that celebrates American history, discusses political theory, and teaches conservative philosophy. Whether it's current events or ancient history, if you care about America, here's a place you can go to talk about the future. Join the conversation and join the revolution.
We've got our guest on the line right now, Dr. Jack Kerwick, and we are proud to have him on. Mr. Kerwick, how are you?
Fine, guys. How are you guys doing?
Oh, we're just yeah, angry and proud. Can you hear that?
I got that impression. Yes. Yeah, but I think a lot of people can probably relate to how you're feeling right now.
I'm telling you what, you know, we're just working men out here all day long seeing what's going on in the world, and sometimes it's difficult to be optimistic about the future.
Yeah, sure, it certainly is. Well, first of all, I just want to thank both of you for having me on. It's a real honor, and it's a pleasure, and it is the first radio show I've ever been invited on as a guest, so I really appreciate it, and please call
awesome.
Me Jack.
Oh, great. Thank you, Jack. I want to say real quickly, Jack Kerwick writes over at The American Thinker. That's where I found him, a jewel over there. His blog is The Philosopher's Fortress. Also, Jack, you're at The American Daily Herald.
Right, that's
right?
Correct.
You're at the Intellectual Conservative. You guys, our listeners will remember Intellectual Conservative because of the beautiful and passionate Rachel Alexander.
Yes, that's right. Rachel's the editor over there with her brother, I think.
Yes, great. And Interstage Right as well. That's another site. Is that a writing site of yours, Matt?
Yes, it is. I've been writing for Intellectual Conservative for, I guess, about 2 years or so. And American Daily Herald is a brand new website that just launched about 3 months ago or so. I've been writing for them for about a month. Interstage Right, too. I've just been writing for them for about a month. Interstage Right is a weekly publication. It's it's published every Sunday night, I think.
Oh, that's great. Okay, I'm going to put that link up in the chat room.
I got it already. Look for
that.
Yep, got it already in the chat room for all of our listeners.
Okay.
Excellent. Let's get all of those up there. I mean, all of us have bookmarked Intellectual Conservative anyway. I know that that I do, but let's get the rest of those up there. You've got a doctoral degree in philosophy.
I do.
Specialized in ethics and political philosophy. And then something sweet. your research interests pertain to classical conservative tradition, for example,
right.
Edmund Burke.
That's
and
right.
That
I can share some stories. I double majored in philosophy and religious studies at a small Christian university in North Carolina. It's called Wingate University. It's about 20 miles west or so of east or so of Charlotte. And then I went to get my master's degree in philosophy from Baylor University in Waco, Texas. But I was born and raised here in New Jersey, in Trenton, actually. And after I got my master's degree, I came home, and my wife and I had met the summer before that. So we got married, and we've been in New Jersey ever since. I'm in South Jersey now. But while I was here, I began my doctoral work in philosophy at Temple University. And let me tell you, boys, Temple is the belly of the beast. When it comes to militant left-wingism, So I was definitely alone.
Hey, are you a conservative out of the closet? Were you a conservative out of the closet?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. I didn't make any secrets about that. Well, I tell you, it brings me no satisfaction to say this. I really felt that my time at Temple could have been so much more enjoyable had I been surrounded with people who were a bit more open-minded to my views. Now, I don't want to give you the wrong impression that I was mocked or ridiculed. None of that ever happened. But it would just blow your mind at how just unaware so many of my colleagues, both students and professors, were of this classical conservative tradition. I mean, when they fought conservatism, they fought George W. Bush. And this was during the Bush years. This was particularly during his second term. And and so it wasn't a real friendly environment.
Were your views in class and papers that you wrote, were they ever punished by professors?
No, I can't say that ever happened. I heard all sorts of horror stories. I can tell you with certainty that there wasn't one of my professors that I can recall at Temple who wasn't solidly ensconced in the hard left. But I never believed that I was penalized by anyone because of that. And my dissertation advisor in particular was his name's Lewis Gordon. He had a conflict going for a while with David Horowitz when he was up at Brown. You guys may remember having heard about the controversy that erupted at Brown University about 10 years ago or so when David Horowitz took out an ad in Brown's student newspaper in which he posted several reasons for why he thought affirmative action was a bad idea. And I don't agree with Lewis Gordon, the position he took against Horowitz, but Horowitz mentions him in his book, 101 Worst Professors, or something like that, I think it's titled. But Lewis Gordon, he's black, he is Jewish, and he's an atheist. And he's he really is a far left, but he was very supportive of me. And during that year I was working on my dissertation, my father died very unexpectedly from a massive heart attack. And he was also very, very accommodating, very understanding. So I have to give credit where credit is due. But unfortunately, I didn't have anyone there who was really very sympathetic, or I should say really very, very knowledgeable of the tradition that I was trying to explore.
Well, I mean, it goes to prove that decency isn't constrained by some kind of ideology. It's a willful...
It doesn't have to be. That's right.
Yes, it doesn't have to be. And so, Jack, that's good to hear. And, you know, Frank and I are very passionate about certain things, and we have deep disagreements with our friends on the left. But there was a time when I thought, well, we can disagree with them, but we're all trying to get to the same place, tell myself when I was younger. I've come to believe, Jack, that is actually not the case. They're still decent people, but we're not trying to get to the same place.
That's absolutely right. And I was going to say, in fact, I'm not trying to be shameless here, but just today, American Daily Herald published the second of these two installments of mine on academic bigotry. And I do recount, to some extent, my experiences as a graduate student in Temple's philosophy department. And in case you or your listeners wanted to check that out sometime, is a very disconcerting feeling knowing that you are the only person in a discipline that's ostensibly committed to the disinterested pursuit of truth who thinks it all like you do. It really is. It's just a cold environment. I was very uncomfortable, unfortunately, while I was there. But I made it out in one piece, and I stuck to my guns So I guess I should be grateful for that.
Yeah, well, we are. That's great.
Yeah,
Frankie?
Well, I appreciate that.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Well, I was going to add, you know, that was my experience when I went to, I attended college over at Cal State San Marcos down in San Diego,
okay.
Doctor, and that was my experience. My experience was usually debating political issues, especially in history classes. Usually it was about a 1-on-20 debate, including
that's
the
right.
teacher, me by myself debating the whole classroom. And it could
that's
be very discouraging at times. I mean, extremely discouraging at times. And so in my experience, I just add this real quick, Doctor. I was punished on my papers for a lot of my political opinions. In fact, Shane here was helping me with some of my papers at the time, and we were just stunned at some of the grades that I would receive. And so, you know, some of those horror stories that other students have received that I've heard of, for me it's hard not to doubt that. But, you know, I guess my question is, why is it that the universities tend to skew to the left so far? Is it because government funds the universities and therefore feel obligated to support government or big government ideas?
You know, I'm not sure if that question admits of a single answer. I mean, it's an excellent
yeah.
question, and it's one that I remember raising when I first entered college. I remember posing that question to my philosophy professor, and you know, he just noted correctly that the left has been represented in large numbers in academia for quite some time. I'm not sure if this is, if this isn't, a legacy maybe of the Enlightenment. You know, it was during the Enlightenment that this particular inception of rationality came into its own and eventually came to dominate. And the idea here was that, you know, reason is independent of all historical and cultural contingencies, that it transcends tradition, and that it even doesn't need God. You know, this is what's called rationalism. And the left has always gravitated toward this this ahistorical or transhistorical vision of human reason. And I think that even though a lot of today's leftist academics are self-avowed postmodernists, and as such, they claim to disavow that idea of reason, they're still indebted to it, because this explains why they think that politicians can command economies, can actually redistribute
yes.
wealth. This, I believe, is a legacy of this fictitious Enlightenment idea of reason.
It's a hubris, Jack.
It is.
It's a hubris, and the way you frame that, from a reason transcending tradition, it's no wonder that you're a lover of Edmund Burke.
Burke's a huge influence on me.
Well, if you think of, and I can understand, I mean, when you're talking about visions of utopia, which is ultimately what I think defines the left as this kind of a vision of utopia, where we're going, what we can create, how we can take this. And, you know, it is evolved from Plato's Republic and this kind of rule by the elite, and Thomas More and Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Karl Marx and B.F. Skinner, and you're kind of moving through these thinkers who are taking human beings and they're trying to ham-handedly kind of force them and change them and change nature to conform to something. And you do that, Jack, by taking away the institutions that would kind of conform a morality to them, or I mean, if you're Rousseau and you think that it's society that has actually ruined human nature, or it's just somehow maimed it, or Karl Marx and his economic determinism, or something like that, and then you come to like what we're dealing with today, just the beginning of transhumanism.
That's the
idea that, you know what, we don't even have to worry about changing human nature anymore, friends. We can just create it in the lab.
Yeah,
we're just going to kind of create our human beings.
Yeah, and it's something that, even though a lot of, like I said, contemporary academic leftists are committed to these postmodern beliefs, or but the idea that the Enlightenment has failed, that that truth and objectivity are just instruments of oppression that have been created by white heterosexual Christian men. Yet when push comes to shove, it becomes painfully obvious that they do indeed endorse just those ideas that they claim to reject. If not, they wouldn't hold up racism as being an absolute evil, right? They wouldn't refer to sexism and Islamophobia and homophobia as being... See, I think a lot of self-identified conservatives today have struck upon the wrong culprit when they look for what animates the left. A lot of self-sworn conservatives today say that it's the left's commitment to moral relativism that informs their judgment.
Okay.
I disagree.
Yep.
The left is not relativistic at all. The left is as absolutist as anyone. I mean, you try suggesting to a leftist that racism itself is an idea ridden with problems, and see your reaction. You think the left? You think any leftist is ever going to concede that racism may just be a social construct, and that even though we may condemn racism, it's okay if another culture wants to affirm it? There's no way. That is not going to happen. The leftist is an absolutist, but he's a dishonest, an intellectually dishonest absolutist. He's not a skeptic. He's not a relativist. He's just relativistic and skeptic about the other guy's moral judgment, not about his own.
Amazing. I mean, how much history are we going to have to endure and study to realize it's an optimism-driven depravity?
That's a nice way of putting it. That's clever.
Yeah, it kind of drives to left. I mean, right now I'm kind of reading through a lot of the French Revolution and kind of trying to parse it out how that happens, and
right.
Rousseau moves to Robespierre and Sartre and the Jacobins and the Sans-Culottes and the kind of idea. Well, you know, should we kill 12-year-olds? Should we murder 12-year-olds here? And well, yes, we feel it's a bad thing to do. It's not right to do. But then again, in order to improve the world, in order to recreate the world, well, maybe that's what we have to do. And so, do I love my humanity enough to kill children?
Well, that's,
do
that's,
I? That's, I do.
That's correct. It's a they love humanity so much that they're willing to slaughter as many human beings as they can for it.
Why am I laughing? That's
Wait,
just
because
terrible.
It's so crazy. That's why. It is.
Yeah, I know. It really is amazing, you know, what the left has really turned into modern times here. And I think it's kind of, you know, the opposite of what they proclaim to stand for. You know, it's funny, every time I think you bring this up, Doctor, every time I hear a leftist try to tout themselves as being open-minded and tolerant and open to different opinions and views, you know, you just got to shake your head because, you know, liberals are by far the most intolerant people on the face of the planet when their ideas are challenged. I think that's ultimately the whole idea behind political correctness in our society. It's not so much that they're trying to protect certain minorities, but it's to try and silence speech that they don't like, Doctor. You know?
Yeah.
That's where I think that's I believe what is the core of PC.
Yeah. Yeah, I the can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
'Cause I'm getting a little bit of feedback or something on my end.
We're not hearing it over here.
Okay. I think you're correct that the that intolerance or tolerance rather that this is a rhetorical weapon that the leftist has been able to wield in order to advance his own agenda. There's no question about that. But what really concerns me, Shane Frank, is that the contemporary establishment right, and I'm talking about Republicans as well as the so-called respectable conservative media, to which Jack Caschle referred in his most recent book, Deconstructing Obama. The same respectable conservative media that gave him the cold shoulder when he was trying to advance his thesis that it was Bill Ayers that's actually the author of Barack Obama's Dreams from My Father, not Barack Obama. And Caschle sounds perplexed in his book as to why the so-called respectable conservative media gave him such a chilly reception. I pointed out in a review that I wrote of his book that was at American Thinker, I think, on Friday, that he can't possibly be as surprised by this as he's making himself sound, because the establishment right, what he calls the respectable right, is as enthralled to political correctness as the left. And again, it brings me no great amount of satisfaction to say this, but it's true. I mean, if you tune into Fox News, or even if you listen to, you know, AM talk radio, yes, I mean, you may hear some stuff of interest, and Lord knows I've been a talk radio junkie for years now, but there are certain hot-button issues that these hosts and pundits simply don't touch. And when they do have to start treading in those waters, if you listen very carefully, if you look between the lines, what you'll notice is that the terms are always the terms of the left. If they're criticizing affirmative action, they always do so on the grounds that affirmative action harms blacks or that affirmative action doesn't work. They'll never point out the most powerful reason against affirmative action, that it discriminates against whites.
Yes.
When they talk about or when they defend, say, Sarah Palin and Michelle Bachmann against the unjust criticisms to which both of those ladies have been subjected, they do so by calling their left-wing opponents sexist. Or when they're, when they're waxing indignant over, these so-called Islamists or Islamo-fascists. Again, these are just fundamentalist Muslims or Quranic literalists, if you will. They'll do so in part on the grounds that these Muslims are sexist or that they're misogynistic. When he talks about same-sex marriage, you'll notice every so-called respectable conservative always qualifies his rejection of same-sex marriage with an affirmation of civil unions. So, I mean, and I'm not saying that these are necessarily bad positions. What I'm pointing out, though, is that these are still within the bounds of political correctness. And so, we use the politically correct vocabulary, charging our opponents with racism, sexism, anti-Semitism, maybe. Every time we do that, Christophobia, I mean, I've heard some people on the right say that.
Yeah.
We're actually strengthening political correctness. We're not dismantling it. And that's use those words.
So if the left is controlling the language in which we are arguing or which we are debating the issues of the day, that in itself circumscribes the debate. Right?
Right.
It puts up, right. And so let me ask you then, is it right for a conservative to say the term the N-word?
Mm-hmm. Listen, if it's within a proper context, I'd say absolutely. You remember so many months ago, Dr. Laura Schlesinger got herself into some trouble? You know, and I heard some conservatives like Michael Gallagher, for example, who I happen to like. I heard him, come out and shedding no short supply of tears over what she encountered. And Sean Hannity did the same. Look, Laura Schlesinger has been in this position for years and years and years. She used that word in order to make a point. Okay? She even, it says after the fact, that she used it to make a point. But then she comes out and she apologizes, and then she turns around and steps down from her job. Maybe people demanded it, but no one was literally forcing her out. She chose to resign because she said she felt constrained. Now,
yeah.
To me, her conduct made absolutely no sense. The woman needs a psychologist. And, you know, here this is Dr. Laura I'm talking
about. Dr. Laura needs a doctor. There you go.
Right? You know,
well,
I would have liked her too, but here, she had an opportunity to take a stance. She wasn't using that term to berate anyone. She wasn't using it as an epithet to hurl at anyone. She was using that to make a point, but then to act as she did, she just gave it all away right there.
Well, Jack, and I think you hit on a lot of great points, and one of my favorite articles of yours that I had the pleasure of reading here as we were leading up to the show was entitled The Race Game in Obama's Campaign for 2012. Now, I think that's a brilliant article. In that, Jack, I think we're going to be talking about race for the next 2 years, and if he wins, we're going to be talking about race for the next 6 years. And I think, oh, man, we're going to be talking about race to no ends throughout this next campaign. And with an economy that is in the tank right now, with foreign policy issues just falling apart on Obama's watch, the world literally blowing up under his administration right now, I mean, what else are they going to have other than to make America feel guilt for its past sins?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, there is no doubt about it that that this next election, race is going to be a big factor, and unfortunately, I don't see anyone on the horizon on the Republican side that I think's going to be gutsy enough to really engage that battle, to really invite it. Maybe with the sole exception of Donald Trump, and even that I'm not so sure about.
Yeah,
I heard about that. I heard about that interview today. I was at work. Did you hear that on Rush Limbaugh today?
I did not. No, why? Was Trump on Limbaugh?
Yeah, he was. He was a special guest. It was a really encouraging interview. And so, I mean, you know, Donald Trump, for all his baggage, he talks a good game at the very least. And this is a conversation, Jack, that me and Shane have had for the longest time, for all the work that we conservatives do for all the great thinkers and writers and talk show hosts and all the great minds of the conservative movement. One of my biggest things right now that really frustrates me is Mike Huckabee and Mitt Romney really going to be our choices for president in 2012?
Yeah,
I mean, that's,
I know. I like Ron Paul. I know he doesn't have a shot. And even when he was in the primaries last time around, I didn't vote for him because I knew he didn't have a shot. I think I voted for Mitt Romney. But I like Ron Paul because, you know, the man is principled. I think he is a genuine constitutionalist, as they say, that his vision is more aligned with that of the founders than anyone else whose name has been bandied about. But as for Mitt Romney and Mike Huckabee, I have no patience for either one of them. I mean, especially with Obamacare being the issue that it's going to be, and Mitt Romney having implemented something that's almost identical to it, but on a smaller scale. And Mike Huckabee, there is something about him that I just do not trust. I mean, the guy.
I think the word is Jack. I think the word is smarmy.
He is smarmy. In fact, a good friend of mine likened him to the Republican version of Bill Clinton.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, he's
eloquent.
Yeah,
and it's not to say
that I think he's unfaithful to his wife or anything along those lines. But the man seems too desperate to be liked, and to be liked by the wrong people, and I'm sorry, and he just he's also another one who seems to be compelled to qualify every criticism of Obama with a reassurance that he's so grateful that America finally elected a black president. he might as well just endorse him, because I really thought John McCain was very close to doing that when he spoke at the NAACP so many years ago. These guys are jokes. I'm sorry. I don't mean to. I get very frustrated with them. It's going to be hard for me not to vote for anyone who's up against Obama. But
I would hold my nose
if I had to do it.
Absolutely. But, again, to go through another election where we're holding our nose, come on.
I know.
This is a country of 309 million people. 200 million of them are adult age and we have to have more than what we're getting. And I appreciate the fact that we're kind of bringing in a lot of governors. We need governors. That's important.
Right.
So we do that. We appreciate Chris Christie. We're not seduced by it. Him. There are some issues with him that we're sincerely disappointed in.
Yeah.
Mitch Daniels as well. There's nobody that makes us want to get up off the couch and walk precincts for, and we're still waiting for that person.
And unfortunately, fellas, I fear that that we're going to be waiting for a long, long time. I'm serious. From the little bit I heard of Donald Trump, I like what I hear, but we've known a Trump for quite a while. There are just things in the man's past that don't particularly endear me to him.
The man's a salesman.
Yes, and if he's the best that the Republicans can put up, I mean, that is really a sad commentary.
Well, we are social conservatives here as well. Frank and I are. Donald Trump is certainly not one of those. And that's not his life. I'm not concerned about the man and how he's lived his life. I'm concerned about what he represents and what he defends. And in that sense, you're talking about a spokesman. You brought up Ron Paul here. Frank and I are not big fans of Ron Paul. While we respect the strength of principle that he has, good Lord, if we could have somebody with that kind of strength and principle to defend that didn't have a Frank and I have a sense of him being more than generous with kooks, conspiracy theorists, 9/11 people, a foreign policy doctor that often leaves us feeling that it's not it's rather naive.
Well, you see,
in a world that's getting smaller and more dangerous.
Well, I think the foreign policy vision of George W. Bush is a utopian vision. I do.
Okay.
I've written at length about this. I oppose the war in Iraq not because I thought it was an illegal or immoral war, you know, to use the idiom of the left, but because I thought that it's ultimately bound to fail. I think it's one thing to wage a war of aggression against an enemy. It's another thing to try to revolutionize an entire region of the world that's about as hostile or alien to our traditions as any other region. And that's what Bush set out to do. That's what, and presumably that's what a lot of these Republican candidates would like to continue to do. Bush talked about spreading freedom throughout the world. Remember, freedom is a particular thing. I mean, granted, freedom is a general term, but there are as many different definitions or understandings of freedom as there are people who formulate these understandings. The freedom, gentlemen, that you and I value is a culturally, historically specific tradition that's bequeathed to us by Englishmen. And to think that these institutions that have been centuries in the making can just be transplanted like so many pieces of machinery. And over in Islamic soil, to me, it's folly. And so,
well, was it as far-fetched for Ronald Reagan? Was it as far-fetched for Ronald Reagan to say the same thing, to believe the same thing?
Yeah,
in every man's heart is a yearning for freedom, and America should be aggressive in spreading or allowing an environment to exist where freedom blooms.
Well, I mean, it's one thing to say that America should abet the spread of freedom, or that it should encourage the promotion of free institutions. But it's another thing to compel it militarily, especially through war. But in any case, even if it is the case, and I'm not convinced of this at all, that within the heart of every man there is and woman that there is a yearning for freedom, that doesn't mean that we yearn for the same thing. And I would just call to mind here Edmund Burke, who said, I'm paraphrasing now, I don't remember the exact words, yeah, but he said, before I congratulate a man on his newfound liberty, I want to make sure that he really has received a blessing. So I would just say that freedom is just too abstract a notion. You know, again, politically, rhetorically, it sounds great, but as far as I'm concerned, the only freedom with which I have any acquaintance is the freedom of the tradition within which I'm immersed. And I'm talking about a predominantly Anglo tradition.
Eurocentric, yes, definition of freedom. So let me ask you then before, because I know Frank wants to get to the Catholic Church and leftism.
Okay, great.
In there, because we're both Catholics and it's a big deal to us.
Oh,
but
okay, great.
Yeah. Wait, Frank, let me frame this real quickly because it's important. I want to hear this from Jack. What is it? What is the yearning that beats in the heart of every human being?
I think there could be any number of yearnings. But I suppose if I had to really identify one impulse that I think is about as universal as any other, it is an impulse toward transcendence, that I think there is a recognition, however dim it may be, within most human beings, that there has to be something greater than themselves, and that we have the relics of cemeteries, burial sites, going back over 100,000 years, suggest to me that that our remote ancestors recognize this. So I would, and when you look around the world and you consider that, you know, religion is a universal, I have to think that if there is one yearning that we want to say is universally distributed throughout the species, it would be this yearning for something larger than themselves, something outside themselves. And that's something we usually call God.
Yes, okay, and so to simplify it in my thinking then, Jack, is it a sense that there's a cosmic order? Is it a sense of security? I mean, ultimately, is it what we're all yearning for? Is a sense of security? I mean,
I do think that there is certainly an aching desire for order, for security. There's a need even to just make sense of the world in which we live, and I think that, and this all is part and parcel of this desire for the ground of being, if you will, you know, something that just that is the stabilizing force, or what in another idiom we call God.
Did Nietzsche die of insanity or hopelessness?
I don't know.
Can you answer that in 10 words?
What's that?
Can you answer that in 10 words?
Yeah, I always heard he
I'm sorry to hit you on that. I'm just, you know.
Well, you know, but it is true, though, that, I don't know, it seems to me that if you really don't believe in anything larger than yourself,
mm-hmm.
I think the self is simply too small of a target. To which to direct all of your energies. I just don't think that you can sustain all of the meaning that you need in your life. And so there really is a need to look beyond yourself to something else. And I think a lot of people do. If you recall the 19th century Catholic convert to Catholicism, G.K. Chesterton had famously said that the problem when people stop believing in God is not that they won't believe in anything, or is that they'll or not that they won't believe in nothing, is that they will believe in anything. And I think that's a great line.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think you're absolutely you're right, Jack. There. But let me move the conversation on here to your article, The Catholic Church and the Left. Okay, because I got to tell you, this article that I read really touches to the heart of my family here at home. It's a conversation that me and my wife have had many times as devout Catholics. We go to church every week here. We are, like I said, devout Catholics that believe in the infallibility of the theological teachings of the church. But its political positions, especially in the Church of America, is something, Jack, that leaves us absolutely baffled. And you write in your article that progressivism of secular leftism has made sizable inroads into the Catholic Church, and I think you're absolutely right. And you go on to talk about the Catholic Church's position on or definitions of justice and equality. Is there a difference between what the Catholic Church terms or definition of justice and equality and what we in America have come to understand traditionally what justice and equality means? Is this a definition barrier here that we're struggling with?
No, see, I think, you remember before, is this Frank I'm speaking to right
yes,
now?
Yes, this is Frank.
Okay, it's a couple of minutes ago, Shane had, I think it was Shane who asked me, if I do think that Reagan and Bush too were both correct in saying that all human beings yearn for freedom. Well, freedom, like equality and justice, are all abstract concepts, and as concepts, they are susceptible to multiple and sometimes mutually incompatible notions. So, you know, whereas it's true that as Christians, we believe that all human beings are equal insofar as they possess an innate or an inherent dignity by virtue of being created by one and the same God. But that notion of equality before God has nothing at all to do with an equal distribution of material or economic resources. And so justice doesn't necessarily have to have anything at all to do with a more equal distribution of goods. So I think that the problem with leftists in the church, like the problem with leftists outside the church, is that they equivocate upon these terms that Americans have come to think very highly of.
Yeah. Well,
yes.
So then, do you find it, and this is just coming from me, this is how I look at it, do you find it a strange relationship between the left and the Catholic Church in that on one hand it promotes the social justice values of the left, such as immigration and things like that, while adopting the moral values of the right? To me, you know, my moral values encompass the social values that I believe in. I don't think they're separate, but for the Catholic Church, at least here in America, it seems like they are distinguishing and picking and choosing which ones they want to support. Social justice values of the left, the moral values of the right. And I don't think they're two separate things when the church does separate those.
Yeah, I don't know. Now, I know, you know, I make a reference to my pastor in that article that you just read from. And again, this is a very good priest. He's a man who I respect personally. Almost 11 years ago, he married me and my wife. He's from Ireland, too. And but he is very pro-life. Now, I don't know if... No, and I guess I would have to say, I don't think there's any inconsistency in his opposing abortion, but supporting, let's say, a larger welfare state. Now, granted, during the homily, he did not make any explicit references to a larger welfare state. He simply used the term equality synonymously with justice on at least four occasions. And as you guys both know, being Catholics, the homily isn't nearly as long as the sermon in a Protestant service.
Yes, that's right.
Right. So he really made sure he packed equality. Not once was there mention of freedom. And the only time he spoke of justice is when he did speak of equality. And so I don't think there's any inconsistency, logically speaking, between, let's say, opposition to abortion and support for illegal immigration. But nevertheless, there is still a certain cognitive dissonance that Frank, you identify and that I can relate to. There's still something that just doesn't sit well with me, knowing that I can't even get away from a lot of this garbage 1 hour a week inside the walls of my church.
I know. I left a church for that reason.
I can understand.
Out here in Irvine, because of that. And the term justice, Doctor, in itself has, when I hear that, there's an involuntary kind of twinge I get. I don't know why, where I picked that up.
When you hear justice?
The word justice all
yes.
of a sudden is, maybe I'm getting growing jaundiced in my old age, but one's justice is another's travesty. I mean, it seems to me there doesn't seem to be.
Wait, you know something? I can really appreciate what you're saying, because for the longest time, whenever I heard the word compassion, I would react similarly.
Mm-hmm.
And now I certainly don't consider myself a person devoid of all compassion. I mean, I work at acquiring that virtue, but I think because the left has conscripted that term so effectively into the service of its agenda, that the term it took me a while to warm back up to it. And I will say, whenever I hear people talk about the poor, I have that same kind of reaction, almost an visceral reaction, which is why I think it was in that article. No, it was in another column I think I posted on my blog. Mm-hmm. Where I said that Christians are certainly called upon to tend to the needy, but the needy are not necessarily the economically disadvantaged. The needy could be Bill Gates.
Right.
Man does not live by bread alone. We are spiritual beings, which means that anyone can experience emotional, mental, spiritual pain. In that case, they would be needy. As Christians, we have an obligation to attend to our brother regardless of what his economic position may be. So I prefer needy over the poor, because the poor today just seems to have certain connotations associated with it that I just don't accept.
Well, Jack, I'll just say, I think as a lot of Catholics do, myself and my wife, one of the things we struggle with is the issue of immigration. Okay. Now, granted, I try to put myself for the position of being a priest. When you're a priest, you identify yourself as a Roman Catholic priest, not as an American per se. You are a representative of the one holy Catholic Apostolic Church. And so when your flock comes to you, regardless if it's from South America or the Philippines or China or America, they are all your flock, regardless of race, color, or creed. And I understand in a nation that has so much immigration where these immigrants are flocking and running to the churches for help, I can sympathize with the priest's position. But here's where I have a lot of problems with the church and bothers me, and that is that the church plays a very big political game as well. I remember when there was a doctrine put out by the pastoral letter by the bishops, and I forget exactly what it stipulated, but it said that something to the effect that if Americans and citizens don't support a lot of the immigration policies of the church, that their souls may be in jeopardy. And that's when I got on the phone to my archdiocese. I'm out here in Utah, and I made a phone call with my bishop. And I asked a basic, simple question to the secretary there, because he was in the office. She wanted to know what I was concerned about. I said, well, basically this, if I don't support the church's position on immigration, am I going to burn in hell? That's what I said, plain and simple. And the response by the secretary was, oh, no, 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 that's nothing you need to worry about. That doctrine, that pastoral letter was put out in order to address a lot of the racism that exists in this country for people who don't like immigrants because of the color of their skin.
Oh, jeez.
Now, that was stunning to me.
Jeez.
Okay, that's what she told me. This is the secretary of the bishop of the Salt Lake Archdiocese out here. And I was stunned. And I guess my question to you, Jack, is where do we as conservatives go? We understand there's people in need. They come from war-torn nations. The economy's in shambles. You have human rights violations left and right. They're looking for hope. I understand why they're coming here. But I can't get past the notion that, you know, that we need sort of a civilized method to bring in immigration. And somehow we say that, we're racist.
Oh, yeah. I mean, gosh, and if they think you're a racist, they're probably going to think that I'm just a cross burner. Because as far as I'm concerned, I mean, yeah, absolutely. You can't help but to sympathize with people who are in those circumstances and who really are looking to improve their lives by immigrating to the United States. But I don't know why anyone who looks around and sees the effects of mass immigration, legal or illegal, could possibly think that America could just indefinitely sustain this kind of immigration and remain recognizably the same country. I've been reading for quite a while and writing, but however much I learn, I simply haven't reached that level of sophistication that I could justify that to myself. I just can't. I mean, because I was born and raised in Trenton, New Jersey. I don't know if either of you know much about Trenton, but by and large, a cesspool of a city now. My mother still lives there. My grandmother still lives there. My old neighborhood is a different neighborhood from when I grew up. When I was growing up, it was all white. Now it's predominantly Hispanic, some black, some old timer whites are still left. But it's not just different. Racially speaking, I mean, crime is higher. The what businesses are there are all different. It's the quality of education has deteriorated. I mean, these are facts, and when people point out unpleasant facts, especially if they're white people pointing out unpleasant facts,
They're
immediately branded a racist.
Yeah.
I mean, if you can point out to me any single area that has benefited from third world immigration, please do that. I just haven't met anyone who's been able to do that. And even if the area has improved, why should people who have built up a certain area, who have acquired an affection to it going back generations, why should they celebrate their own dispossession? I don't get that.
Well, see, if education as a civic institution was training Americans to love their country and love their culture, race would not be an issue. Whatever color you are, wherever you come from, it would not matter because that is the melting pot, but it's no longer a melting pot, Dr. Jack Kerwick. See, that, it's a salad bowl, is what the left likes to call it. And that's why when we hear the term social justice, that's become the rhetorical equivalent of a sock full of quarters swung at groin level.
Right.
It just doesn't, it gives you a reaction, none of it's good here. And that's a damn shame, because ultimately America was born of the yearning for justice.
Right.
The idea that there is an inherent dignity in being a human being, to be ruled over by a monarch hundreds of miles away, oceans away. We can rule ourselves. We have the capability of doing that. God has given us that. And so, in that sense, yeah.
Yeah, well, like you said, things, I don't know if I'm as hopeful for the future as you guys are, but I guess we have no other option but to try to be as hopeful as possible. I guess that's why we're doing things like we're doing right now, to make a difference.
It's why you're writing. We appreciate every word that you do. It's why Frank and I come out every week and do this, and our little blog, and the interactions we have with the people around us, to try to have some input and some influence in America. Because our generation right now, this generation alive right now, as we hold hands with the past and reach into the future, into the next generation, there comes a point when we have to ask ourselves, Dr. Kerwick, what this generation will be remembered for. Will it be the generation that lost that American-ness, lost that connection, lost its freedom, began to not understand the kind of poignant example we are in human history, the long, dark history of humanity, how special America is, the bright light in the long, dark hall, that we do have a responsibility? Or is this the generation that inspires a revolutionary generation that comes after us, like those before the revolution in America? Is this a generation that is the revolutionary generation? With all that's going on in the world right now, can we say that America is immune from its own revolt now?
And that could, like you said, I mean, even though I guess maybe being a conservative, I tend to be a little more pessimistic, but no, I'm not completely without hope. I mean, in a sense, I'm really grateful now that John McCain lost the election, because because we have Barack Obama, and it's precisely because Obama moved as abruptly and aggressively and far to the left that he did, that I think we started to see a reaction. And I just think it'd be a real shame if we lost the momentum that we have right now.
Yeah.
You know, the November elections were very encouraging. I really just hope that we continue with the wind at our backs. And so you never know, you know, that something big could happen soon, and I'm just going to hope that in any event, we slow down the rot.
Well, that's the best. There you go. Regain that optimism, my friend. We've been talking to Dr. Jack Kerwick. You can find him at American Thinker, The Philosopher's Fortress. You can go over there. I've been spending a lot of time there, too. American Daily Herald, Intellectual Conservative, Venture Stage Right. Doctor, we are so happy that you came on, and we kept you a long time, and I do appreciate it, because I know time is precious here, but I've got so much to think about. Here,
well, listen, it's been a real pleasure, and I hope I don't get you guys in trouble with some of my thoughts on immigration. I didn't know if that made me uncomfortable or not, but I just want to be honest. And
it's honesty and clarity is what we ask of and demand. And it's a shame that it would take some semblance of courage to do that, Doctor.
Well, I appreciate, gentlemen. I appreciate it greatly. I hope you have me come back sometime. I'd love to be on.
We can't wait. Okay. What are you doing tomorrow night?
You're only on Tuesday, right?
I know. I'm just It's just great. You're just awesome, and I really appreciate you taking the time. And like I said, you've given us a lot to think about, and we really do appreciate you coming on to Political Vindication Radio. Dr. Jack Kerwick, thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much. Take care, folks.
Thank you, Jack.
Thank you. Friends, you can find him very easily too. Well worth the read. I've got all of his articles here, and I've got cut out a bunch of his quotes, Frank, from all these several articles that I wanted to hit one by one. Revolution in Burke. You talked about the Catholic Church on the left.
Yeah.
Obama wants to ruin America. That challenge. Islam on its own terms. The race game, which you brought up a little bit earlier, Frank. I mean, there are so many things that he touches on and talks about, and I'm looking forward to kind of like many of the authors, Frank, that we've talked about on our show, which when we get them on, Frank, we end up finding out more about them and where they write and where we get to find, it's kind of the trail to the wellspring.
Yeah.
Because
I
know there's more of Dr. Jack Kerwick. I know there is. We've gotten a taste of him, and when I read of him at American Thinker, I said, this is somebody special. But to know that there's another place that goes back a few years that allows me to kind of follow him back a little bit more, well, now that's exactly what I'm looking for, Frank. It's exactly what I'm looking for.
Yeah, and I agree with you totally. It was a complete joy to have Dr. Kerwick on with us tonight. And it's like I was telling you before we did this interview on the phone, I mean, these articles are right down our alley. It's the stuff we talk about, we debate every day here or every week on Political Vindication, what we write about on politicalvindication.com. He's hitting a lot of issues. And what I really appreciate about Dr. Kerwick, and I know he was apologetic there at the end about the sort of the race issues and, you know, again, he brings up issues or points that a lot of people are too afraid to bring up. And I think that's something here at PV, we've always prided ourselves on that. I'm going where a lot of other people won't go. We're kind of like, you know, the Star Trek of Blog Talk Radio here, man. We'll go, you know, into areas that no other man will ever go. And I think Dr. Kerwick is very similar to that, Shane, that he will touch on issues, and you can read his articles, that many people are afraid to because of political correctness or being called racist or bigots or whatever you have it. I mean, you got to admire his courage at the very least.
Love that.